Well, good news, everybody. As you can see, the Sonata now has a homemade but very successful set of headers. We actually just made this out of random exhaust pipe, even actually metal pipe, whatever I had laying around. To be honest, I was not about to go pay $150 for a set of headers, not knowing if this thing was even going to run correctly, and just gamble on the purchase. Luckily, I was able to get to the original exhaust pipe that was torched off from when the catalytic converter was torched. I still have the flange right back there. So I unbolted the flange, took that off, laid that out. And what I've been doing, which I recommend to a lot of you guys, if you have cars that are really clean cars and it has a good long set of exhaust tubing on it that's not rotted out, especially one that has a lot of bends and curves, elbows, things like that, 45 degrees, cut that off your car, cut it up into smaller pieces so it's easier to store, hack the elbows into small lengths, stick them in a box, pieces of straight, keep them at like, you know, maybe 2 foot lengths or something like that, and stick them in another box next to it or all together, and keep some of that stored away, because it is so much easier to just pull out a box, have all your fittings you need, lay them out, and you can just weld them up together, seam weld them, and just like that, you got a set of headers that I made in literally a couple hours, put it all together, fit right on first try. It doesn't get better than that. And as you can see here, this is actually one from one of my cars because it still has the O2 sensor here. I did intentionally put that there just in case, for whatever reason, this car needed an O2 sensor in order to run correctly. I could unscrew that one. We could take the O2 sensor that was from the original exhaust down here on this car, and we could have screwed that back into the header, and you can still get somewhat of a reading that could potentially fix any weird engine problems associated with an O2 sensor. Most of the time, in my case, I just unplug the O2 sensor because that will make the computer do a default programming code, and the engine will still run without them. Just be careful if you snip the wires. Sometimes you can have really weird errors by snipping instead of unplugging, and definitely do not leave them plugged in, just reading airflow under the car or anywhere, because then it will detect there is no air going through the engine, and it will affect all kinds of weird stuff, potentially even throwing the car into a limp mode on some Chevys if you even plugged in and hanging. So always just unplug and see what happens. But that is not the case for this car. The good news is that was 100% the problem. I had a feeling, knowing some other cars, Tauruses are notorious for this. If you do not, if you have way too short of exhaust, there's no back pressure in the pipes, it doesn't clear the cylinders well enough. I mean, I don't know the full details of this. I'm by no means an engine builder. I'm just telling you that's the basics of how it works. By adding pipe here, when the exhaust clears out of the engine, it's sucked up out of the pipes. That airflow, each RPM, the revolutions, it's basically like a vacuum. It's clearing the chamber. It's putting in fresh gas and fuel. The mixture is correct, and it just runs. I don't know beyond that. Somebody else can probably give a way better explanation. I'm just telling you now, if you have a car with the exhaust missing and it's running really rough and idle, you can hear the engine searching like it's going up and down like waves on the radio, then that's kind of one of the first things to look for, is does it have actual exhaust on it. And as soon as I put these on it, by the way, this thing fires right up, purrs perfectly smooth, exactly right around 1000 RPM when it starts cold. And then as soon as it warms up, it pulls itself back down, probably to about 800, I think, if I'm remembering right off the top of my head. So it's running perfect, no misfires, no searching for any type of movement in the engine. Love it. But that, enough about that. We'll get this thing running here in a future video. Today's video is a very, very important one that I hope a lot of you are coming here today to learn with me. And a lot of you, I'm encouraging, if this is something you are very uncomfortable with, if this is your biggest flaw when you build derby cars, if this is why you lose, if this is why you're scared to run front-wheel drive cars, if electrical is the biggest problem for you, because don't worry, don't be afraid. A lot of people, it is. I know guys that can build amazing motors. They can weld up their cars. They put cages in it, and they make the car tough as crap. They'll put some plates on it. But boy, when it comes to electrical, that is where they're weak, and they go and end up losing because stuff just doesn't get moved correctly, or they run cars and leave way too much factory, and they could have had a really built car that just gets knocked out super, super easy. So today, what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically talk out loud what is in my mind. I'm just going to speak my mindset as we walk through this car. I'm not physically going to move anything yet in this video. I've besides putting the headers on this car, guys, I have done zero research on anything under the hood of this car. I've not looked up anything on Google, anything about these cars for Derby World. All I've done, put the headers on it. We made sure this thing ran. That was my number one priority. If it ran good, okay, now we can build it. So check, that's off the list. So now we're gonna walk through this and we are going to basically diagnose and look for anything that we can make better, make move out of the way, things that could be problematic. It's all just looking through and spotting those type of easy wins to make your car last longer. As you can see here, we have preemptively taken off the core support. Why? Couple reasons. Number one, this entire thing, it's plastic. It's just gonna shatter and fall apart. Will I even put it back on the car? I don't know. We're gonna come back to that in a future video. Number two, a lot of these Hyundais, the Kias, I believe even my Dodge Avenger was the same way. This is your bumper mounting plate. It's an awesome flat metal plate. You don't even need a welded plate on your car. It's really good flat mounting surface. Unfortunately, when the bumper bolts on there, this plastic cover is on top of that and your bumper bolts through the plastic cover to the metal. So therefore, it is impossible to weld a bumper on the front of your car if this plastic plate is there in your way. So you're almost forced to remove this core support or cut this huge chunk right here out of the way to weld your bumper on. In doing so, this is now going to sag and it's also going to be touching your bumper when you weld and probably catch this plastic core support on fire while welding. So it's just much easier, pull it off, get whatever bumper you're gonna put on your car, figure out, if you don't have to weld it on, maybe tack weld the bumper on, then figure out how to put that on. But we're gonna come back to that in a future video. We're gonna diagnose and problem solve everything with that later. That's just why it's been removed. So let's start here on the passenger side. So with all of my cars, most of my front wheel drive cars, especially four cylinder, I will be looping them for most of our stock class rules. Just because, as you saw there at the plastic, we know it's gonna be a problem with these things. So let's assume this radiator, this AC condenser, all of that is being removed so we can install a good loop kit and keep everything protected out of the way. And we'll go into that again with a later video. We're focusing on electrical, but let's assume all of the coolant system is being pulled out of the way in order for us to do this. Starting over here, what do we have that's just here? Let's look at it. First off, we have a windshield washer box with probably some kind of a sprayer, which is right here. Obviously, car does not need a sprayer to function. Do not cut wires, guys. Do not cut wires. Do not cut wires. I cannot express that to you enough. I cannot say how many times people have messaged me where they've snipped a random wire and it triggers security. It triggers a ground wire to fold out. It does really weird stuff the way these computers are programmed nowadays. Just unplug it. It's so much easier and safer. You will hate yourself when you destroy a good car to scrap. So you will unplug that right there, easy enough. Boom, that wire's out of the way. And what I like to do is I will follow this wiring harness one at a time to see what else we can pull from this bundle. So we know now we've undone this sprayer. What else is up here? We have another wire coming off the side of it. Looks like it's going down underneath here. We're gonna follow it along and it goes into the bottom of this washer box. So again, it relates to the washer fluid. That tells me both these wires can be unplugged, not gonna affect the car. My guess is one of them's a sprayer. The other one is probably your sensor that tells you when this is empty, but doesn't matter for us. Continuing on, these are loose. These are probably from headlights from the core support when we took that out. As you see, they're unplugged. They will mean nothing to me. We will end up probably just wrapping them out of the way as far back to the strut tower later on as we go. Moving up here now, what do we have coming up off the same bundle of wires? We have a wire here that plugs in to these aluminum lines. Anytime you see bright silver aluminum, 9 times out of 10, that's probably your air conditioning lines. A dead giveaway is if you see these little pressure fittings, these things, drop the cap, doesn't matter. That is for sure air conditioning. If you ever see those little caps and you take that off, has looks like a little nozzle, like you fill your tires. And you can always follow them and you'll know because they go to your AC condenser right here. So those things do not matter. That again can be unplugged and we will be removing all aluminum air conditioning lines. Number one, because we have to in order to remove the AC condenser. Number two, aluminum is worth way more money than basic steel, so I cut that out of all my cars. I save it up in a big old bucket. Later on when we scrap stuff, we have a separate aluminum pile we will cash in for good money. So that stuff will come out. So this is now unplugged. Moving on, we have this last wire on the bundle. We're gonna follow it. This here is some type of fluid. We have not touched that yet because we're not dealing with fluids in this video. We will come back to that at a different point. For now, we've just moved it out of the way and we'll address it later. Let's make sure we get the electrical done first and the car still runs before we do other crazy stuff. The last wire in this bundle here on the passenger side plugs into a little sensor with a yellow plug. Now, I'm gonna tell you guys right now, just from experience, from doing years and years of cars, you will learn it over time as well. If you don't know what it is, you could always Google it, look it up. Worst case scenario, there's a bunch of writing on this here. You can actually look up the part number. You could type in your car, whatever year. So this thing here, we could type in the year of it, Hyundai Sonata, type in sensor number or part number. This one even says serial number. It gives you both. You type it all in there on Google. Odds are somebody on eBay, some parts store is gonna pop up and you're gonna get a pretty good guess at what this is. Off the top of my head, because it has a yellow plug, keep in mind, yellow, 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 so important. Anytime you see a yellow plug, the most vehicles are standardized across the board for safety. That is an airbag sensor, probably for crashes. Most of the time, if it's a yellow plug, unplug that right away. Definitely probably do that before you pull airbags out of your car. This is, you know, to be safe. There's no accidental airbags going off. There's no release of power. Any crazy stuff later on when you're messing with the car. So that can be unplugged. So what have we done? Boom, unplug, 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 unplug. Now everything back to this main wire has been unplugged. That's awesome. That now means this guy back to here has been cleared and we can wrap it up out of the way. Following along, what else do we run to? We have a wire here that I can't see that goes behind the washer box. Can we see it where we are sitting, or will that have to wait until the washer box itself comes out of the way? I'm gonna bet we're gonna have to wait, but I can't tell from here. It looks to me like it is another random sensor. So probably we can unplug it and we'll be safe. We'll unplug it when we remove this washer box. We will make sure the car starts with this sensor unplugged. The car does not start, if it does not run, we will plug it back in, we'll keep the sensor connected, we will relocate it with the wire somewhere safe. Moving on. The main harness right here, we now hit our very first ground wire. Anytime you have black wires or you have metal that's been bolted to other metal is a ground wire. They're gonna be bolted for your headlights, for your fans, anything up front is going to ground out an electrical current. Most vehicles, modern vehicles especially, the 90s cars, they put grounds in weird places for very important things, like really stupid places. I'm talking like some cars would have a ground wire attached to the rear bumper or the taillight package that grounds your fuel pump. Really stupid. But most modern cars, they've made things standardized again, much easier. Most of these grounds will not be needed. If you ever are doubting if they're important, unplug it. Does the car start? Does the car run? Does it move? You're good to go. If it does need to be used, any ground wire, never keep them anywhere on the front of the car. So this ground wire, say we need this one, we will undo that bolt. When we suck all these wires here, this whole corner now, we're gonna bring them wires in here. We're gonna bring them all the way back here to this strut tower. We're gonna clear off the paint. We're gonna take a piece of sandpaper, a grinder. We're gonna make bare shiny metal. And we're gonna take that grounding wire and we're gonna take a self tapper or a screw or something. We're gonna bolt that in right there. Heck, I've even seen some people, and I've done it myself, see this bolt? These are the three bolts for your strut. You can take this nut right here off your strut, clean up the metal so it's bare metal, put your connection right here for the ground wire, slide that over this bolt and re-put the nut down, and you've now made a ground right there through the strut tower without having to use your own screws. Only if it fits and it's big enough, but it does work. So there's the basics to those wires right there. Following up in here now, it looks like we have another plug to another random sensor right here. That one could be a relay. Maybe it's important, maybe it's not. Again, what we'll do is we will unplug it. If everything works, we don't need it. If we do need it, we will keep it with the bundle. We're gonna end up wrapping this whole bundle of wires and goodiness in a big ball, put some electrical tape around it, and then just shove it back there to the strut tower. If you can get it even further, pull it all the way back to right here where the wipers are. We're gonna pull this plastic cover off under the windshield, right there in that hole. Stick all your wires in there. If you're allowed, put some spray foam in there. If you're not, zip tie it, electrical tape it, it's good to go. So we've now pretty much done everything right here on the passenger corner of this car and moves it all to the strut tower or better. This is just electrical, so ignore the other hoses, fluids. We'll come back to those later. Deeper in here, just looking with my eyes, we see a box right here. This is diagnosis on it. I know off the top of my head, this is where you plug in your computer scanner, read the computer. You're gonna wanna leave that. If you ever have a weird error after a derby, you may wanna actually get the computer read. Fun fact, if you guys don't have a computer scanner, keep your car on the derby trailer after the derby. You can literally drive to almost any parts store, Advance, Napa, AutoZone, all those fun ones. And even if it's a derby car, as long as you have a plug-in for a scanner and you have a battery that will turn the key on, they'll do a scan on it for you and they'll tell you if it gets any kind of an error code pop-up. I have done that before on derby cars. They will do it. So definitely want that. We'll leave that. Working our way back now to the front. We've done the passenger side. We're just looking right now what else jumps out at us. Way down there, that is our air conditioning pump. Now, how do we know that's an air conditioning pump? Well, remember what we talked about earlier, guys. We said all these silver, these aluminum lines, you can follow that line, that hose there. That goes with all these other aluminums right there. There's a cap. Remember I talked about them caps. You see a cap? That probably means it's air conditioning. That means that line goes to your air conditioning pump because you see the silver aluminum line. So in that case, we know we can unplug the air conditioner right there with that wire. We'll follow that wire back and get that plugged out of the way. That's just one less thing to short out or get caught and drag underneath the car. So nothing in front of this looks like electrical wiring. Underneath it, this car thankfully has nothing underneath. Some of them have a bundle under the bottom of the radiators. There's nothing there. We've now worked our way through the front of this car. I've already moved the electrical fans, so those are no longer in our way. The wires for the electrical fans, I think, were probably right here. That was the clip form. We've just unplugged them. That's hanging out of the way. And this right here is actually part of the hood latch, which can just get tossed. It was laying down in our way down there. And oh, look at that. We found a wrench. That's not mine. That came with the car. What a deal. We just got ourselves a nice wrench. So, working ourselves along this now, we've covered the passenger corner. We've covered the front half of the engine. And we're going to the driver's corner. What is all going on over here with electrical? Well, remember, this was from our fan, so we know this guy is not important. We can follow it, and it has one of these little plastic clips right here. You just give her the old 1-2 yank, it'll snap loose. It's now off the frame. You now got a nice long pigtail, and we also know where it goes to is the bottom of this little computer looking box. Now, what is that computer box? I have no idea. You don't have to know what these parts do, guys. All you have to be able to do is either A, unplug them and see if the car starts, or B, look at whatever's written on them. Half the time they'll tell you. If not, you type the number in on Google and it'll tell you. You don't have to be a mechanic to really build derby cars. They're quite simple nowadays. So on here, we just see something called a PWM controller. What is that? I have no idea. But I bet you I'll look it up later on and I'll probably end up removing it because I bet you it's probably not important if our cooling fan plugs into it. So moving on, right here, another ground wire. We just talked about the other side. Boom, here we go. This one, if not needed, we can unplug it, tuck it back there. If it is needed, we will unbolt it. Hopefully when we move all these wires, we will bolt it somewhere back here by that strut tower or further back. What other wires can we find up here? We have a random plug right there. What does it do? I don't know. It goes to a really big wiring harness right here that goes to the motor, so we can't follow it this way. Let's follow it the other way. Walking down here, we see it join this bundle of wires. So it's probably connected to one of these spots. What's in here? There is another ground wire. We'll undo that. We'll see if it's important. And right there is another yellow connector sensor. You guys remember what yellow means. Yellow, yellow, yellow. Yellow is the color for safety. Yellow is the color for airbags. That means that's another airbag sensor on this side of the frame. That can be unplugged. We'll move on. What is this right here? This, I know off the top of my head, is a relay based on what it looks like. What it does, I don't know. I'm guessing potentially a relay for the fan, just because our electrical fan was plugged in right here with this wiring harness, it could have controlled it. Again, this is something we can look up online, Google the serial numbers that are right there on it, or we can simply just unplug it. If the car starts, runs, and moves, we move on and go to the next part. See how important it is, guys? This is why I wanted the car to be running perfect before we did the wires. It's so, so important that you don't have mechanical issues going on while you're chasing wires, because then you could be potentially fighting two battles at the same time. You don't know what is affecting which when you're doing that. So we've talked about moving this thing. We've talked about unplugging these and looking them up. We talked about our ground wires. We've gotten this whole corner now dealt with. We're going to move back here and see what else is going on. It looks like, just like the passenger side, there's a random sensor underneath the fender right here. The exact same sensor on this side is the exact same one on that side. If that's the case and those sensors are the exact same, I'm going to guess they're probably not important. Anything important is going to be a one type deal, not a double deal. So probably unplug it and move on. We'll give her the old test. We've now moved ourselves back to whatever all of these goodies are. This is obviously our negative to the battery. It grounds right here to the car. That's a terrible spot. Remember what I said, no wires on the fenders. No, no, no. So those are going to get unbolted. We will put our own negative battery cable on our battery when we move it in the car. We will make sure it gets grounded somewhere, probably in the car, up here to the motor. We will check all those grounds and make sure they're good. So this will move. Up here, we have a battery tray. It's plastic, probably doesn't need to stay. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4 bolts that will come out. This tray will lift up and out of here. That's just less junk. You don't want to leave that in there. Why? If this frame bends, and if it bends that way, then all you got to do is say, okay, let's pretend in our mind this frame bends. What will this tray hit first? Well, off the top of my head, just looking, first thing I see is a transmission dipstick. Tranny fluid, extremely flammable. Probably a bad thing if that tray hits it. That's the number one reason to definitely move this. Number two, it looks to me, our shifter linkage is directly underneath there. That's even more important. If this battery tray goes on top of the transmission and hits your shifter cable, it's gonna lock up. So for sure, ditch the plastic tray, out it goes. Just by moving those four bolts, you guys have now had an easy win in eliminating a stupid problem from taking you out in the derby. So we've officially cleared out this corner of wires, the center part of wires, the left part of wires. What is left? This big daddy right here, the old fuse box. There's not much you can do about these fuse boxes in modern cars. You can simplify them, you can remove fuses. If you guys have a car where they sell wiring harnesses, you know, your Hondas, your Camrys, your Luminas, then you can buy one of those plug-and-play harnesses. But let's be honest, the newer and newer we get into cars, the less likely we are going to have a wiring harness that can be simplified, just because there's so many custom programmed and tuned features to these modern computers. It's going to be really hard to get into them and actually tune them correctly like they do for those older cars. The older computer software is much more easier to mess around with. It's not as protected like it is for the modern functionality of these systems. So, of course, I've already undone the nuts right there, and right there on the side. So this guy is loose. So, couple ways we can go about this. Number one, the easy, lazy man way. If you are not able, for whatever reason, to move your fuse box, if you've moved all the other wires and this sucker still is stuck where it's at because the other bundles just will not let it move, the wires to it are too short, you're not allowed to move it, whatever the case, number one method, undo all the hardware that holds this fuse box in place. Make sure it is always free-floating. Never make it tight. You know why? Because the first time this fender tries to twist or move, it is going to put pressure on that fuse box. If it cannot shift and move with your fender, it is going to crack that box open, it's going to split, it's going to find somewhere to give. That's an electrical short, that's causing a fire, or B, it's frying your computer, which is basically killing the car for the rest of your life. I mean, it's not easy to get a computer, especially one if it needs to be custom tuned to each car from the dealer. Try bringing a derby car to the dealer. It's not going to go out so well. So, very important to make these things live as long as possible. If you cannot move them, undo the bolts, add anything possible to protect them. I don't care if you're taking rags, if you're taking seat belts to put padding around them, if you're taking spray foam, which is the number one preferred method if allowed. Anything you can do to keep that thing as protected as possible. Zip ties even, just to suck it out of the way, hang it off this air box, put some holes through this air box, and have zip ties to hold it so it doesn't flop it around as bad. Heck, you can even run zip ties through the factory hole right here that we had the bolt in, and then loop those zip ties right here around this threaded rod and put that nut that was on this back over the zip tie. So you now have that zip tie held to here and held to here. It holds this guy in place, but it still allows it to shake around and move when that fender moves with those zip ties. That's number one, lazy man method, or I can't move it method. Number two, after we've moved all these wires, we're gonna go ahead and try to find the most length we can from these long wiring bundles. Anywhere that it's been clipped or attached to the car, just like you saw right here, where we ripped one of these little stupid plastic clips off the frame, there's gonna be a bunch of these guys holding that wiring harness in place. Snap all those loose, see how long you can get it pulled out. If possible, get this fuse box somewhere as far from possible from the front. Ideally, probably right back there. There's a good hole, there's a gap. You can sit it right here on top of some of these metal lines, zip tie it to your brake booster, zip tie it to your firewall, whatever you want to do. Worst case scenario, put it underneath your air box right here. I mean, the air box is big and hollow. There's a big hollow gap underneath it. Just get it away from the fender. Ideally, put it up there in the firewall when you remove this plastic part second right there. You're good to go. That's what a lot of guys do with the Luminas. But every car's a little bit different. So that's what we will do once we've moved our wires. We will attempt to see how long this will stretch. I have, in some special scenarios, flipped these things over. I don't know if you can see it on this box. So some of these boxes, you see how they got these tabs? You can undo these plastic tabs. This case will come apart. There's a top half and a lower half. It will come open. They're just plastic covers. And this wiring harness here, and the one coming out the back, right back in there, that guy, those will actually have connectors. That is just a big bundle, a big, just like you see right here. This plastic connector would be one of these, but like 30 wires. And it will plug in underneath the fuse box. Usually there's a bolt that tightens them in there. Undo the bolt. You can actually unplug these wiring harnesses from the fuse box if it helps you. Take that whole fuse box, stick it somewhere else where you want it. You can even flip it upside down for all I care. It doesn't matter which way it faces. Then you can take your wiring and you can pull that bundle if you need to unwrap it out and around from things and re-plug it back in to the fuse box. And don't worry, you're not accidentally going to forget where they plug in, because it is intentionally designed by a factory to every fuse box. Those plug-in connectors are designed only one special shape, so they can only go back in the exact same place you pulled them out of a fuse box. Very simple. They do that not because of us. They do that because of the people that are working in the factory building these cars. Those people are doing how many of these a day, and they're going really fast, plugging things together. They idiot-proof it. They make all those plugs super different, so nobody is going to accidentally flip the wires around, fry the brand new car that they just built in the factory, and make everybody mad. That's why they do that. So, we've now successfully, hopefully, moved our fuse box, cleared out all the wires from up front all the way to the motor. And to be honest, guys, if there's any other wires that are attached to the motor or sitting behind the motor, it's very unlikely those are going to be your culprit that will ever eliminate you from a derby. The only scenario where wires in the back of the motor end up costing you the derby is A, they get melted and caught on fire. So just make sure, especially with headers, you have no bundles of wire touching or able to move and touch anything hot. Which for this one, there's nothing back here. We have coolant hoses to the heater. And over here, it looks like we have a wire plugged into some kind of a line. See that right there? We're going to look at this hose. What does that go to? Boom, right here. If you still don't know what this is your power steering pump. But if you still don't know what that is, keep following it. Here's the line coming out, line going down. Boom, here's your fluid box. All you got to do, look right there on the top of it. You now know that is power steering. See, you don't have to actually know what these parts are. It's super simple nowadays. If you had no idea that this was a power steering pump, you just follow whatever things plug into, and sooner or later, it's going to show you something super obvious that will give it away. So we know that that goes to a power steering connection. It's probably a sensor to see if there's pressure. Might be important. I don't know. To be honest, I'm going to play it safe and keep it plugged in for this car. What I will do, though, is you see how this harness likes to flop around? I will take a zip tie at some point later on. And we'll just take this wire and we'll zip tie it over here on the left side. I don't want it going to the right, getting close to these headers with a chance of melting and giving me steering problems if there's any kind of a weird alert system and warning, whatever sensor to the power steering system. But Whew, that was a lot of knowledge. That was a big dump. That was 30 minutes of roughly me just rambling. But again, that was off the top of my head, no planning, just me looking at the front of a car. And this is the exact process I use, guys, for every front-wheel drive derby car that I build. You take everything you can off first. You take your bumpers, you take your core support. I will definitely hopefully get this radiator out of my way. Anything I can that's just blocking your eyesight, because you don't want to miss one wire. Literally, one wire will cost you the win at a derby. Trust me, it's happened to me. It's happened to many other people. You don't want to be that guy. It's so easy to miss one super simple thing that can cost it all for you. So it's worth, and you're sitting here going, oh man, it's 95 degrees today. I'm sweating my butt off. I really don't want to undo this radiator. I really don't want to pull this stuff out of the way. Well, ask yourself, are you going out there to just junk a car and then immediately buy the next car? Are you trying to get three runs out of your car and not spend any extra money possible to buy more derby cars? Then you take the extra half hour, the extra hour, whatever it takes you to pull that stuff out of your wake, because time is free, but buying cars is not. So the little extra time all adds up to be this beautiful creation at the end of the day. But there you guys have it. I'm going to start doing exactly what I just now talked about on camera, starting with the front of this and working my way across all these wires. Stay tuned. I will show you in a future video the end result of this thing looking beautiful, cleaned up, and hopefully we'll fire it up for you to see how it runs.